Dr. Gerhard Greller, he is also working for Sartorius, Director Upstream Technology. Gerhard joined Sartorius in 2006 as well, so it seems that many people joined Sartorius in 2006. Gerhard is leading the Upstream technology team, and he is also the project leader of our of the development project of our single-use stirred tank bioreactor that we currently are, the largest scale that we are currently having in development is 1,000 liter, and we have just initiated also the 2,000 liter scale development. And Gerhard, before he joined Sartorius, he worked for Aventis in Frankfurt with the insulin production process, and specifically you were involved in looking at scale up, scale down models to understand the situation in the 40 cubic meter insulin production bioreactor better. And Gerhard will now speak about design principles of our single-use bioreactors. And after that, we then will start inviting other people on the scene that come from other companies, so giving us also the user perspective.
Thank you, Crystal, for the introduction. So I want to guide you to a very short 10-minute presentation which is linked to characterization and scale-up consideration for single-use bioreactors. In the agenda you see that first I will summarize some basic topics, and one was already mentioned, the scale-up or scale-down model systems. Then I will try in this short time to define a simplified design space. And in the end, I will show you the data for the characterization we did in Sartorius for the small-scale 2-liter single-use bioreactor and for the large-scale STRs. So if we look today on the market, what is currently existing in terms of single-use bioreactors, we can see that there are variations between standard stainless steel bioreactors and the single-use systems. And what is currently well-established for C-Train is, of course, the wave systems. But we have also other kinds of bioreactors, mainly maybe driven or coming from mixing systems, where later on a sparger type was included. So what we see is we have not classical stirrer positions, we have not classical impellers, and also gassing strategies and spargers are most of the time different. And finally, not for every scale, if you think on a 5,000 liter bioreactor, this is currently not existing in single use, and of course this is also linked to that one if you plan a transfer from, for example, a 1,000 liter steel tank bioreactor, single use, into a stainless steel one. If you talk about scale-up, I think most of you know already some most important terms for a scale-up. First of all, which is always very beneficial, is to have a geometrical similarity between the different scales of the bioreactors. Most of the time in cell culture applications, the tip speed is used for a scale-up, but more experienced people use also the power input per volume, which is also a very attractive scale-up criteria. But finally, because that is all linked most of the times to mixing, finally, of course, we have to reach the KLa value because we, the cells need the oxygen. From my experience, this is all nice, and scale-up can be discussed in details with CFD models and whatever, but in the end, the knowledge and experience of a bioreactor design or the user is also important and very important. So what we need currently on the market is a better comparability between the single-use bioreactors and the stainless steel one. So I will guide you through a very draft design space theory. So in the end, if you look at the steel tank bioreactors, there are two main tasks such a bioreactor have to fulfill. First of all, it's of course mixing. If you run a fed batch process, if you add sodium hydroxide during the process to control the pH, it's of course very important that you don't have big mixing times or large mixing times. And on the other side, we have a limitation in terms of stirrer speed, of course, because of shear stress for mammalian cells. On the other side, we have the oxygen transfer rate, which is also linked to PCO2 removal, most of the times linked to the type of sparger, but also scale dependent. So we have, in the end, agitation and aeration. And what I now try to do is to give you a short, guide you very short or briefly to a definition of scale-independent parameters, bioreactor design characteristics, and in the end, the engineering parameters. If we talk about geometrical similarity, yeah, so you can see in this slide, and I don't want to go all through set values, I only want to highlight that we, for that kind of bioreactor, we try to keep certain important ratio parameters constant. And here you can see a nice picture of the different impellers and shafts we used in our single-use bioreactor. If we want to create a design space, and if we now concentrate on the difference between the agitation and the aeration, you see we have limitations which are, first of all, also coming from the hardware, because we are talking about single-use bioreactors. I think nobody can expect to have an 800 rounds per minute steered large-scale bioreactor. So, but we are currently today talk about mammalian cell culture. But of course, steerer speed is always linked to a certain tip speed. Of course, that is linked to the specific power input. And finally, of course, to the impeller shear rate. And that is very important in cell culture applications. For the gas flow rate, we have, of course, from the physical parameters and from the scale-up criteria, you can see that in every book you will read on scale-up, you see that also the superficial gas velocity is a very important parameter. But I want to concentrate today on a very simplified system. And on the end of the day, as I said already before, we need to reach the KLa value for the growth of the cells. Now I can show you some very briefer summary of the results. So we did a lot of trials with the single-use small-scale bioreactor, so the 2-liter universal, and of course with the larger scales, a 50, 200, 500, and 1,000-liter bioreactors. We characterized it in terms of mixing time. We measured the torque. We could calculate the Newton number, and with that we are able to calculate the specific power input, and finally, as I said, important KLa. This is only a very, very short table, only to keep you in touch when we talk about tip speed on the later on in my next slides, that you are aware in which range I'm talking about in terms of steerer speeds. So you can see that in the large scale, we, of course, have to reduce the steerer speed. And we set, as here mentioned, and you can find that also in every book you will read about cell culture and scale-up, that there is, in the literature, you can find a value of a maximum of 2 meters per second for a maximum for cell culture applications. So here you can see the results of that one. What we did were of course, conductivity measurements with a tracer, and we did the decolorization method to show also that we have no mixing or bad mixed areas or volumes in our bioreactor. So what you can see here is, as I said, this is tip speed. You can see that if you want to reach a mixing time of below 30 seconds, which should be acceptable in cell culture applications, you can reach with all of such systems very easily that value. As I said, with the torque, with the Newton number, and this is the benefit of the single-use bioreactors, this is coming from our side, so you are not able to remove or change the configuration of that system. So we will always have the defined characteristics from our side, which means, for example, a 3-blade segment impeller 2 times. So we did the torque measurements, the Newton number calculations, and the power input calculations. And you can see that if you set a limit of below 30 watts per cubic meter, then you can reach with all set systems set value, or you can use set systems to reach set value. In terms of KLA mapping, of course, a standard sparger type is the ring sparger with from 0.5 to 8 millimeter drilled holes. And on the other side, we are currently starting with the evaluation of a micro sparger. But I heard from a lot of customers at the larger scale, nobody likes the micro spargers because of the problems with PCO2 stripping and with very hard to remove foam. So what we decided is we go in an intermediate step below the usually used 10 to 20 micrometer spargers and so in between of that range. This is these are the results for the KLA measurements, and as you can see, you can easily reach with all of the bioreactors and KLA of 10. I think, and I come to that maybe in my next slide, that if you see or if you see what is the need, what do you need for your large-scale process? And this is a very good resource. This is a report from different companies who defined a standard prototype monoclonal antibody process. And what they are describing is that if you need to reach a cell density of 50 million cells, you need an oxygen uptake rate of 1.5 millimolar per liter and hour, which means in the end you will need or end up with a needed KLA value of 7. So if we look now at the different single-use bioreactors, 2-liter, 50, 200, and the 1,000-liter bioreactor, you can see that if you use a tip speed of 1.2 meter per second, you will reach the KLA value by using air. If you now ask, okay, but I want to reach a cell density of 30 million cells, it's very easy. You just have to use pure oxygen because, as you know, you can increase oxygen transfer rate by the factor of nearly 5 by using pure oxygen. And these are, in the end, the first results we created in-house. So we compared the standard the standard ring sparger with our current micro sparger type. And as you can see, you can reach much higher KLA values by the factor of 2 if you use that kind of spargers. I know there's a little bit, a lot of people are skeptical in terms of micro sparger types. We have done a trial with another company, with DSM, and you can see the poster around. So, short summary. If today someone would ask me, I want to run a CHO process in a single-use bioreactor, what should I choose? I would tell them, you have to specify your needs. For example, a mixing time below 30 seconds, a power input below 30 watts per cubic meter. I would give the advice to use a tip speed of 1.2 meter per second. And keep it maybe constant. As we all know, increasing the stereo speed will also increase the KLA value. So this is something you can maybe on a later stage of the process, if there is a need, and to reach the KLA value or the oxygen uptake rate, I would use a cascade 40% constant of PO2 of 40%, and you can control it by using air, oxygen, to the end. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions.
Yeah, any questions to Gerhard?
Hi, any comments around foaming ring sparger versus the micro sparger?
I think that is always depending a little bit on the media you use. So if I jump back on that slide, if you use currently a ring sparger type, you have to go up to 0.1 VVM gassing. If you would use this micro sparger type and you need the same KLA value, you can reduce the gassing by a quarter, to a quarter of that. And this is, of course, we have to prove that in a large scale, which is starting in June, on a 1,000-liter scale, we will have a CHO cultivation, and then I can give you, I think, that feedback.
Yeah, and what I also recommend is go to the poster, the DSM poster. I forgot the number. It could be around about 460 or 470. Thank you, because there at the 50-liter scale, you can see data on foaming, PCO2, DOT, and that in a very high cell density culture, and that is really encouraging data. I think the great thing with the 150 micrometer sparger is that you're not going really down to this really small 20 micrometer uncontrolled or more or less uncontrolled pore sizes. You're going to controlled pore sizes, which are balancing basically oxygen transfer on and CO2 removal. So I was really excited when I saw those data. What Gerhard didn't mention, we also have in the pipeline, in the development pipeline, what we call a combi sparger, which is combining the normal ring sparger holes, the 0.8 millimeter holes, together with smaller micro holes. I don't know the size. It's also 150.
150. And the idea is that you use oxygen, the air, through the ring sparger to strip your CO2 and to use a micro sparger for the addition of oxygen.
Yeah, and another comment that I would like to make on that topic, foaming, is that we realized that challenge as well, as many others have realized it, and we have developed a exhaust cooler that would take as an additional mitigation or preventative measure care of aerosols or maybe even higher humidity in the exhaust gas and condensing that out. And the first beta site trials at 1,000 liter scale are soon initiated, I think, with that. We have done in our laboratories, I think we have done experiments up to the 50-liter scale or even 200-liter scale.
Even to the 1,000-liter scale.
Oh, good, yeah.
But this is the first data, the first KLA values, but what we need, of course, is a real cultivation to see the effect.
Further questions to Gerhard? Okay, let me ask then the audience a couple of questions. In terms of scale-up, what problems or challenges have you faced when, let's say, scaling up from your laboratory scale to single-use bioreactors and maybe later on even to large-scale stainless steel bioreactors? Anybody wants to comment on that, or maybe also wants to comment on the kind of parameters that you are using when you're thinking about your scaling up experiments? Nobody wants to comment on that? Yeah? Yeah. Ich verstehe. Eine Minute. I have 1 minute left. Is there anybody who wants to comment anything on scale-up issues? Not really? Okay, then I would say we don't need to sort of drag you along here. I would like to welcome the next speaker.